This hour of the Costa Report is brought to you by Dole Food Company, the world's leading producer and distributor of fresh fruits and vegetables.
Welcome to the Costa Report. I'm Rebecca Costa, and today we are broadcasting live from the G20 summit in London, where I've had the honor of welcoming heads of state and delegates who've gathered to discuss economic growth and opportunity in Africa. This hour, we were supposed to interview the Minister of State of Works for Nigeria to talk about how the 37th economy in the world is going through an unprecedented transformation. And I can tell you that he is still has not arrived in the studio. And I got on the phone with my producers, and it was interesting because one of them said, this is the moment that separates professional radio journalists from amateurs. So I hope I pass the test today. We're in for an interesting report on the G20 summit. I hadn't prepared to give this to you because I was hoping that the Minister of Works of Nigeria would be here and we could share that responsibility. But I have been spending two full days with representatives throughout Africa, as well as funders of projects throughout Africa. And it's been a very enlightening 2 days. I can tell you that it's been a very optimistic time for the people of Africa. Although one of the, disappointing aspects of this conference is many of the same issues that were addressed in last year's conference are still on the drawing board. And we'll talk about that in just a moment. And as you know, since I'm broadcasting from the BBC studios in London, we are on Royal Baby Watch. And somebody said something kind of fun to me. I'd been on my feet for 2 days here at the G20 summit. And they said, I bet when they started talking about inducing labor, you didn't think that they meant you. No, I did not think that inducing labor meant I would be standing on my feet for 2 days. This gathering in London has been a very important one because, as you know, the gold rush has been on in Africa to seize up oil rights as well as mineral rights. And we can see the greatest growth in the countries which have acted quickly to work out deals, if you will. There's a lot of talk during this conference about what's called PPPs, which are private and public partnerships. And those programs are in particular advocated by Baroness Linda Chocker, who was the Minister of Europe and also was the person that oversaw investments from the UK in Africa. I had an opportunity to visit with her at the House of Lords at the British Parliament, and she is very interested in why these partnerships are not going well. I have my own theories, and we'll talk about that in just a moment. But essentially, the bankers are trying to relay a very clear message to those who want money to build out infrastructure throughout Africa. And even though these are not their words, of course, as financial professionals, they use different words. What they're looking for is the lowest risk possible. They know it can't be zero, but they'd like it to be as close to zero as possible. And they're looking for the largest returns that they can get out of Africa. And the reason that their investments in Africa fundamentally appear risky is because of political instability. To go in to build a hydroelectric dam is a very long-term proposition, a very expensive one. And it will take quite a considerable amount of time for an investor to start seeing profits from that. And in many ways, they can't move forward on projects like that independently without the government. So there is no choice but to have a private and public partnership, particularly if the government can't afford to build out those kinds of infrastructures on their own. And so the basic problem is when you're looking at a very long-term project, a very expensive project, one that has to be paid out over time, you have to immediately think about who is the customer for that project. And the customer, obviously, would be the citizens of that particular nation. So that's what the government brings to the table. What the government brings to the table is the support, endorsement, and brings the customer to the private investors. What the private investors bring are money. You know, they bring money to the table. and they need to recoup that with a considerable amount of profit. And when there's a politically unstable climate, as you're seeing in Egypt right now, or as you used to see in Angola, that was many, many years ago, and I have some good news about Angola, which we'll talk about in just a moment as well. But when you see that there's a lot of internal civil war and strife in Nigeria, we see that the Islamic factions in Nigeria are really creating a great deal of threat to the stability of Nigeria, despite the election of Goodluck Jonathan. And I think that's such a wonderful name, Goodluck Jonathan. It's a fabulous name, and what a remarkable citizen to rise to the top of Nigeria. But I will say that investors are looking for as close to a zero risk as possible, and they want to see political stability. And it's very difficult for them to think about investing in hydroelectric plants and in railways and basic infrastructure in Africa unless they can see those ingredients. And so the message was pretty clear from those that represent different development organizations, different banks from around the world. There was a very large Portuguese contingent here, a very large contingent from Brazil, who has been partners with the African nations for many, many years, and also, of course, a very large European contingent as well. Now, there are some things that I've observed at this conference, and today I made a rather rousing speech. I got a lot of reaction for it. When I go out on a limb, I'm a rather conservative individual, so when I go out on a limb like that, most of the time I wind up regretting it because it raises so much controversy. And so I'm generally one of those individuals that would rather have my guests speak and listen to what they have to say and keep my head down and just mind my own business. That might not seem like something that you'd expect from a radio personality, but I think that that is what makes my program unique. I think I'm not so eager to get my opinions out on the air so much as I'm curious, just as you are, about what's being done and what maybe people in leadership positions might think about and how they view our problems. But I did go out and a bit on a limb today. I was offered 25 minutes on the main floor to talk about my observations of the G20 summit. And it was I did say something that I think was a little disturbing. And so there were so many questions about it. We broke to a special room, and the room was pretty much packed with people that had questions. Because remember that the ministers of transportation, of education, of finance from these African nations are all present here, and they're all looking for how to get their projects, their infrastructure projects, funded. That's why they're here. And the banks are here to tell them how to get them funded. And so there's a lot of side rooms where discussions are going on that are very real and very important to the future of Africa. But one of the things that I noticed is the narrowness in which we're describing infrastructure. And I see this as extremely problematic. When we talk about building out infrastructure in Africa, we're talking about railways and pipelines to be able to get oil, extract oil out of Africa and get it to other nations. We're talking about being able to get minerals exported in a more convenient way. And the infrastructure that they're talking about is infrastructure that the United States was looking at 200 years ago. And so I'm a little bit concerned about that. And we're going to talk about that a little bit more. We're coming up on a commercial break. When we come back, I'm going to talk to you about traditional versus non-traditional infrastructure and why I think Africa is being trapped into developing technologies and infrastructure that won't last for very long and won't be to any competitive advantage. So we'll take our commercial break and we'll be right back. You're listening to the Costa Report.
This Legal Minute is brought to you by Nolan Hammerly, Etienne & Haas, experienced attorneys providing professional legal services to the Central Coast for 85 years.
Hello, this is attorney Stephen Wagner with your Legal Minute. Have you ever said to yourself there ought to be a law for that? Well, often there is. In this segment, I will address the issue of social media and hiring practices, and specifically the potential employer's right to snoop around in social media networks to gather information about the potential employee. From the employer's perspective, social networking sites must seem like a treasure trove or petri dish, overflowing with valuable information. The hot-button legal issue that has arisen recently relates to the employer's request, or worse yet, demand for the candidate's password and/or username. It is this conduct by the employer that has sparked outcry and controversy based on privacy rights, and this has led to legislation and the enactment of laws that now prohibit employers from making such demands or requests. Such is the case in California and several other states. It would now seem that the lid has been placed back on the petri dish. However, it is important to note that employers still have a right to access all public information, that is, anything the potential or current employee chooses to share, publish, or make public. In other words, these laws do not protect job seekers from their own stupidity or indiscretions that they decide to gloat about by publishing their escapades on the World Wide Web. So it seems that discretion is still the better part of valor. This is Stephen Wagner, and that's your Legal Minute.
Brought to you by Nolan Hammerly, Etienne & Haas. Selected in 2013 as one of the top law firms in the United States by Martindale Hubbell.
I've been talking about Sleep Number for a while now and how much I love my bed. My goodness, it's made such a tremendous difference in the way both Celeste and I sleep. My Sleep Number bed is up there around 100. I like it nice and firm. Celeste, 80 or so. What's great about the people at Sleep Number, they're always looking for ways to improve the way we sleep, and they've done it again with a memory foam bed. The all-new Sleep Number memory foam bed is a perfect combination of cool contouring foam and the unique adjustability of the Sleep Number bed. Dual air technology. That's what makes their memory foam bed unique. At the heart of the mattress are two individually adjustable air chambers that allow you to personalize your comfort. It's memory foam redefined. You only get this bed at a Sleep Number store. You can enjoy introductory savings of $400 on the all-new Sleep Number memory foam bed. And right now, during their white sale, you can stock up and save on their exclusive bedding collection. There are 400 Sleep Number stores nationwide, but the one you want is on 41st Avenue in Capitola Mall. Say hello to Carlos, the store manager, and be sure and tell him that Charlie Friedman from the Happy Hour program on KSCO is the one who sent you down.
They call me Mr. Mom, and I'm here to talk with you Fridays, 7 p.m. about the big challenges of raising families in modern times. Hi, I'm David Marine, the author of This Is Us, the story of my adopting and raising, single-handedly, three children who do not look like me into young adults. And that's why they send me cards on Mother's Day. On the Mr. Mom radio show, we'll talk about being moms and dads, married or single, about teaching children right before they get taught wrong, about turning a house into a family home. Let's talk about the real big family challenges on Mr. Mom, Fridays, 7 p.m. Remember, Friday is Mr. Mom Day on KSCO.
This is us. This is us. This is us. This is us.
Welcome back to the Costa Report. I'm Rebecca Costa, and if you're just joining us, we are reporting from the G20 summit in London, where the entire country is on baby watch. And I guess I'm on baby watch here. When in London, do as the Londoners do. So to continue my discussion about what is going on with the G20 and what is happening in Africa, and this does influence us. I know a lot of people are saying, why are you covering Africa? Well, it's because some of the largest oil reserves in the world have been discovered in Africa. And of course, there's been a land grab to get in there and grab not only oil and gas rights, but also mineral rights. In the meantime, what do the African nations want? They want to build out infrastructure. But here's where I have a problem with what I've observed at the G20. The kind of infrastructure that is willing to be financed is old infrastructure. It's exactly the infrastructure that we're trying to abandon in the advanced countries. Let me give you an example. It's easy to get a loan for a hydroelectric plant, for example, but not so easy to get anything related to solar. And so what happens is a lot of the projects that can get funded tend to be things like stringing electrical and phone lines out to villages. Now, if you live in London, where I'm broadcasting today, or you live in the United States, you know that buried phone lines are an old infrastructure that we're forced to service. In the meantime, everyone's moved to cell phones. And so to the extent that Africa has an opportunity to bypass old infrastructure, they won't be saddled with servicing it the way we do, we are, and they'll be able to move much more quickly. And yet the only kinds of projects that can be financed is the continuation of building out old infrastructure. I want to give you a specific example that I used in my presentation today at the G20. They were talking about you've got to go build more airports. You need more airports throughout Africa. And they were talking about the fact that they wanted funding for those airports. Now, first of all, I don't know how a private investor gets their money out of building an airport. I'm sure there is a creative way to do that. But one thing I do know is that in a project like that, it would take a very, very long time to recover your money and make a significant enough profit. So you're tying up a great deal of capital over a long period of time. And those are not ideal investments, particularly when there is no clear exit strategy. But here's the problem I have. Even if you got busy building airports today, the fact is that Richard Branson is already building spaceports. So by the time these airports are fully functional, we won't be using airports anymore. We'll be using spaceports. And if you're not familiar with spaceport projects, we've now demonstrated that the most efficient way to fly long distances is to go directly at an angle into suborbital space and then come back down. In other words, we won't be flying horizontal to the Earth's surface anymore, because that's a very inefficient way to get from one area to another area, particularly if there are long distances. It's a lot more efficient to fly up into suborbital space and then come back down. And so there are, I believe, 7, 8, 9 spaceports being built around the world. Even if Africa, the nations in Africa, got busy now building airports, there maybe those airports would be valid for 5, 10, 15 more years, after which that infrastructure is no longer valid. And so what I think is the big opportunity for Africa is to go immediately to state-of-the-art, bypass the old infrastructure that advanced nations are saddled with and are having to service while they try to move forward. Remember, we have the burden of all underground gas and pipelines and underground phone lines, and we have to maintain those while we're maintaining cellular towers and satellite communications. Africa doesn't have that burden right now, nor do they have the myriad of regulations that keep a nation from moving forward. Google has announced that they're going to be putting these big blimps up with cellular towers so that people throughout the Sahara Desert area will have internet access. But can you imagine blimps flying all around the above New York City or San Francisco, a dozen blimps flying around? There is no way that regulations would allow something like that to happen. And yet we don't have those issues in Africa. So in my view, the fact that there are very few regulations, and those regulations are open-ended at this time, the fact that they don't have old infrastructure that has to be dealt with, and the fact that they can move to state-of-the-art programs. I talked to them about space-based solar as an example. We can admit to ourselves that these mattresses that you lay out on your roof or you lay out on the ground to collect solar energy is old technology. You must know it's old technology because it's been around since we were in high school. Yes, the efficiencies have increased by a significant amount. I don't want to take anything away from that in the solar industry, but that is not the best way to capture solar energy. And if you're interested in what I'm saying, you could go Google space-based solar energy. The scientists at NASA have proven that the best place to collect solar energy is in outer space where you have no atmospheric interference. And they've developed certain types of very specialized cells that power the satellites out in outer space. And they have constructed arrays of made out of these specialized cells to capture a great deal of solar energy. And they have proven that by putting a simple satellite dish on a home or a business, that they can beam down a diluted form of energy and store it in a battery at a local area. Now let's go to Africa and take a look at the implications to villages in remote areas that don't have electricity, can't run water purification systems, have no power to be able to offer remote education over the internet or run computers, not even charge their cell phones. If the alternative is to string a wire all the way out to that village or go directly to space-based solar, where any person who has the ability to install a satellite dish similar to your DirecTV dish can have power. And not only that, let me just tell you one more benefit to that. That is that when the weather changes, when you have storms and you have rains and that kind of thing, you don't have power outages, not when it's coming from outer space. And there's absolutely no environmental impact to doing it this way. So you might ask, well, why aren't we doing that in the United States? Well, that's a story for another day, because that's a political issue inside the United States. And I think you know where that's going to go. It's going to wind up at the doorstep of the oil companies. But in Africa, we don't have that situation. In Africa, Africa is the Wild West right now. And the road is wide open for them. And rather than get stuck with old infrastructure, I'd rather see these banks and these development agencies invest in space-based solar, spaceports, water purification systems that are state-of-the-art, internet-based education, 3D printing. In fact, we're going to take a short break, and when we come back, let's talk about 3D printing and the ramifications that that has on old infrastructure. You're listening to the Costa Report.
I'm Amy Tobin, cookbook author and culinary expert. Strawberries, blueberries, blackberries, and raspberries. Dole has a bounty of berries ripe for the picking. Fresh berries are not only delicious, but some of the most powerful disease-fighting foods available. Researchers have found that berries have some of the highest antioxidant levels of any fresh fruits. So add a handful or two of your favorite berries to your next meal and enjoy their nutritional benefits and natural sweetness in all of your dishes, from salads to desserts and everything in between. For fresh tips and ideas from Dole's berry experts, visit berries.dole.com. And be sure to check out the pages of mouth-watering recipes. Whether it's a sweet and savory blueberry cranberry chicken salad or a simple strawberry sorbet, Dole has the perfect berry to inspire your next berrylicious dish.
Hi, this is Dean Sutton of Sutton Law Firm. I want to invite you to consider Sutton Law Firm for your legal problems. We emphasize property law, evictions, easements, boundary line disputes, tree problems, sale of real property, trust administration disputes. Give us a call. New Santa Cruz office at 831-431-6483. That's 831-431-6483. Give us a call at Sutton Law Firm.
When the going gets tough, you need to call Adolfo Garcia. Recently, we needed some work done here at the radio station. We called Community Tree Service, that's Adolfo Garcia's company, He showed up immediately from the phone call. We said what we wanted done, which was a huge amount of work done. He and his staff were here at 8 o'clock the next morning. They followed all safety procedures. Community Tree Service are fully insured, and I was very impressed at the way they cleaned up the area after they'd finished working and clearing a huge amount of brush and trees. I love, love, love Community Tree Service. Adolfo Garcia is the owner of a local business. You can reach them at communitytreeservice.net. You can reach them at 763-2391. If you've got a job to do, when the going gets tough, Community Tree Service gets going. I love this company.
Yes, it is loud. It is raucous. It is fun. So get up and go for it. Take the family. Take the friends. Take the entire neighborhood to the rip-roaring racing fun at Ocean Speedway in Watsonville.
Friday night, it's Ocean Sprint Night number 11 presented by Taco Bravo. That means loud and raucous racing with 360 sprint cars, four bangers, American stock, sport mods, and wingless sprints. Adults $17, seniors 65 plus for 16, kids 6 to 12, 13. Details at oceanspeedway.com.
Ocean Speedway is located at the Santa Cruz County Fairgrounds, just 2 miles east of downtown Watsonville on Highway 152. Get up and go for the loud, raucous, rip-roaring racing fun this Friday night at Ocean Speedway.
Get a new view of the world with Coast to Coast AM.
When do you see this entire picture unfold?
It's unfolding right in front of us. The corporate construct runs our government. And most importantly, they keep us on the two-party system. As long as they can convince the American people that your choices between evildoers, the Democrats, or evildoers, the Republicans, they have absolute control of you. The biggest threat would be a genuine third party.
Hear Coast to Coast with George Norrie Monday through Friday, beginning at 10 p.m. on KSCO.
Welcome back to the Costa Report. I'm Rebecca Costa, and if you're just joining us, we are reporting live from the G20 summit in London. And, I was talking a little bit about old infrastructure, new infrastructure, and the fact that advanced nations are stuck with old infrastructure. They're having to service it. It's a tremendous tax to do that, and it slows down moving to state of the art, whereas Africa really is a blank slate. And so, my message to those development agencies and those banks that were there and interested in funding infrastructure is to open up the definition of infrastructure. I want to see some bleeding edge projects for Africa on the table. Space-based solar, spaceports, water purification systems that run on cow dung. Dean Kamen's got a water purification system called Slingshot, and it requires no renewable carbon filters, no nothing. It's about the size of a small dishwasher, and it runs on about a handful of cow dung a day. So if there's a cow in the neighborhood, you can have clean and fresh water. I also talked to them about internet-based education and the fact that they want to put in all these highways and roads. And I started talking about 3D printing, something we've discussed on this program before. You know, eventually we're not going to be transporting all these products. I know this sounds like something in Star Trek, and we should have William Shatner back on to talk about 3D printing. But if you've ever seen a 3D printer, and I have seen one and printed out a little toy that was operational, if you've ever seen 3D printing, what 3D printing will allow you to do is to see something on the internet, order it, and actually manufacture it at home. So the more that we push Africa into developing technologies that are going to become obsolete, we're moving to a virtual and digital world. And as long as Africa is following hundreds of years behind industrial nations, and we're now prescribing to them old infrastructure that we ourselves are trying to abandon, there can be no hope for Africa. You cannot tell a continent to adopt infrastructure that you yourselves are trying to get rid of.
Rebecca?
And that was the question that I put to... Yes, I hear Bill. I hear... Is that you, Bill?
That's... Yeah, it's your your California engineer. Listen, I have a question for you. You mentioned this twice, and it brings up a good question. Are these folks who are looking at Africa and this and the future of Africa, are they hoping to avoid some of the pitfalls we've done in the United States? I mean, there are some areas of the United States where we have pretty good transportation between cities, but it's nothing like Japan or anywhere in Europe. It seems to me that if they were going to spend money on infrastructure, they would do it in such a way that it doesn't, you don't end up being dependent on cars.
You know, you would think that. And by the way, it's so great to hear your voice because I'm kind of homesick. I'm kind of homesick. I don't travel well, and, you know, I can't wait to get back to the States. But you're absolutely right. They should look at industrialized nations, and they should cherry pick those technologies, those infrastructure projects that worked well and don't work well. The fact is that with mobile applications, you can take care of a great deal of people's health concerns. You can even set up education without schools. While everyone's telling them to build schools, actual brick-and-mortar schools, they should be moving to internet-based education models. While everyone's telling them to build more hospitals, they should be developing fantastic mobile applications that would let you know if you even need to visit a hospital or not, so that they could cut down on the number of hospital visits. They have such a tremendous opportunity to do it right. And yet what's happening is there's no one in there talking to them about what state-of-the-art is. What everyone's trying to do is to get them to catch up to our old infrastructure. And so the comment that I made, and I think it really resonated with everyone in the room, and by the way, this is the great advantage that I have. I am beholden to no one. I cannot be paid off by anyone. You know, I am loyal to no political party. I am loyal to no particular corporate sponsor.
Well, except for the chocolate lobby.
The chocolate lobby. Okay, there you got me. I'm a liar. Anybody offers me chocolate, I'll say anything. The truth does come out. But the fact is that I stood on the stage and I said, I just have one thing to say to all of the ministers, all of the leaders of the African nations here. And that is, just because infrastructure, which is better than what you have today, is being offered to you, that doesn't mean you have to take it. And this is the condition that they're in. Things are so terrible that even if old infrastructure that is a dead end is offered to them because it'll be funded, they're willing to accept it. And I think they should be much more selective. And so what I've recommended to them, and everybody stood up and applauded and got very excited about it, is I've recommended that they allow these bleeding edge technologies to come in and present to ministers. I'd like a full day tacked on to the G20 summit where IBM can come in and show Watson applications in the hospital, where Richard Branson can come in and talk about spaceports and how they're going to work, where we can have representatives from NASA come in and talk about space-based solar and how to implement it, Dean Kamen come in and talk about water purification systems, talk about 3D printing, the greatest companies in the world that offer online internet education, you know, guys that are developing agricultural applications for cell phones. These are the things that we need to get in front of these ministers, because their imagination has been truncated. They no longer have vision. They're now thinking about, how can I get an asphalt road from this village to the other village? And when they said that to me, I said, what do you need the road for? And they looked at me as though I had gone crazy. They said, we want to put an asphalt road in between this village and the other. And I said, what for? They said, so that a truck can go between them. And I said, what for? What would the truck be doing? And they said, well, the truck has to deliver. And I said, look, I don't want to take anything away from it. It's probably a great idea, right? But you're assuming you need a road. You're assuming that that's the best way to get those goods there. You know, you haven't thought about helicopters, blimps, jetpacks. Can you imagine if Africa made jetpacks?
Or even legal? A high-speed train.
High-speed rail for cargo,
yeah,
not passengers,
sure,
would be fantastic. But none of those projects are on the table. None of them are in the works. What is in the works is so old and the kind of infrastructure that is not where the world is going. And I think it was the first time, by the way, that at the Africa Infrastructure Investment G20 Summit, I believe this was the first time that anyone said to them, don't do it. Leapfrog. Because my comment to them is, when you develop a culture of following industrialized nations, the very definition of following is you never get out ahead. You're always behind. That's what it means to follow. And Africa has been dealing with this for how many years?
Right? Forever.
Forever. Their only hope now is to invite in and partner with state-of-the-art technologies and then just bypass all this other old archaic infrastructure that they're putting in right now.
You know, Rebecca, this happened in Mexico when the universities realized that they didn't have any bad old technology that they had to incorporate. And they, all the universities in Mexico now have wireless way before we did because they didn't have anything before it to encumber them.
You know, that's absolutely right. And I know this because when I saw that, I invested in Telefony de Mexico. This was in the 1980s. I saw that only one out of eight people in the 1980s had a telephone in Mexico. And Telefony de Mexico put out a stock offering, and they said, we're not going to go to landlines. In fact, we want to destroy all the telephone landlines in Mexico that exist right now. We're going to go straight to cellular. And that is a perfect example, Bill, of what Africa needs to do, is use that as a model, because that puts them out ahead of the industrialized nations. And that is what will attract capital when they get on that path. All right, we got to take a short commercial break, and Bill and I will be right back. You're listening to the Costa Report. If you listen to the news today, you might come away with the impression that our biggest challenges are political and economic. But if this were true, then countries which have different political and economic systems would be facing different problems. But they aren't. Every government and every nation is struggling with job creation, debt, immigration, climate change, terrorism, healthcare, energy, and wild swings in financial markets. So something else must be going on. That's why I'm inviting you to get a copy of The Watchman's Rattle, a book which shows how the Roman, Mayan, and Khmer empires once faced similar challenges and what we can do to avoid their fate. Visit RebeccaCosta.com today and get a copy of The Watchman's Rattle, because once you do, you'll never look at the world the same way. I'm here today with Scott Caraccioli of Caraccioli Cellars. Now, there's a number of ways you can taste wines at the tasting room. Talk to us a little bit about that.
Yeah, we currently have 9 different wines on our tasting menu, and we really want it to be an experience where you get to taste the wine that you want to taste. So if you want to taste Pinot, you can really focus your flight around that. If you wanted to focus on the bubbles, we have 3 different sparklings that will allow you to build your flight that way. Or if you came in and you just wanted to taste one wine, we would have it set up for you to be able to do that as well.
Now, what's a flight?
A flight is basically a combination of small tastes of different wines. If you wanted to taste all of our different Chardonnays, you could taste the 2007 Chardonnay, the 2008, and the 2009, and we would line you up with an individual taste of each of them.
Thank you for being with us again, Scott.
Thank you, Rebecca.
Seven. Severino's Bar and Grill in Aptos is always busting with excitement. You'll get a family atmosphere, casual dining in or outdoor on the patio next to the koi pond and waterfall. Tasty salads, appetizers, and affordable entrees. Happy hour every day from 3 to 6. If it's live music you enjoy, they have it Thursday, Friday, and Saturday nights. Sports? Watch the games on the 5 flat screens. Severino's Bar and Grill is a great place to meet friends and family. Severino's Bar and Grill, inside the Sea Cliff Inn on Highway 1 in Aptos. SeaCliffInn.com.
Before you head out onto the open road this summer, head on over to North Bay Ford and test drive a new Ford Fiesta, Focus, Fusion, or the incredible C-Max Hybrid. Hello, I'm Bobby Robinson. North Bay Ford is your locally owned dealership with low overhead, friendly, small-town values, and great deals on new cars and trucks. Get this, Bobby's deal at North Bay Ford.
A thrilling summer adventure. You heard right. At North Bay Ford's Summer Spectacular Sale, you'll thrill at the heroic performance and blockbuster deals on the fuel-efficient Fusion, Focus, Fiesta, and C-Max Hybrid. Go now and get your thrilling Ford adventure.
This summer, head over to North Bay Ford and test drive a Ford Fiesta, Focus, Fusion, or C-Max, and enjoy the ride of your life. We look forward to meeting you at our locally owned North Bay Ford, 1999 Soquel Avenue, Santa Cruz, or on the web at northbayford.com.
Michael Olson's First Law of the Food Chain. Agriculture is the foundation upon which we build all our sandcastles. That's right, folks. No surplus of food, no sandcastles. So before we all get upset from the dust and noise of agriculture, let's get together Saturday at 9 a.m. as the Food Chain Radio Show goes behind the scenes of the industry that keeps us all civilized. If you have a comment about the First Law of the Food Chain, tell me, Michael Olson, all about it at metrofarm.com. Now, see you all on KSCO Saturday at 9 a.m. for some What's Eating What Radio on the Food Chain.
What day was that?
Welcome back to the Costa Report. I'm Rebecca Costa, and if you're just joining us, we're reporting live from the G20 Summit in London. And I'm with my engineer in California, Bill Graff, and I was just telling him it was so great to hear his voice. I'm a little homesick.
You're pretty far away from home at this point.
I am, and I don't travel well. I miss my dog. I miss my own bed. You know, it's so great to go out and travel in the world, but that first day that you get home and you sleep in your own bed and you get to take your own shower and go into your kitchen and make your own coffee, gosh, does that feel good.
Hey, I have to ask you, are there any other big glaring problems those guys are talking about over there?
There are. There's two other issues that I really wanted to address. And again, you know, it was my place to address these because I'm not an elected official. I'm not a banker trying to court favor with any country. You know, I think that they need to think about inviting people who really have no vested interest. They don't want anything. I didn't want a deal from them. I didn't want a contract from anybody. I just wanted to make some observations. So when I stood on the stage, I said, I am here to be of service to you. That is the only reason I am here. And I'm here to tell you what I know and what I am observing and what some solutions that you might consider might be, some alternatives, and to open up the thinking a little bit. So the first one was to redefine our definition of infrastructure into traditional and non-traditional, and I'd like to see bankers figure out how to fund non-traditional infrastructure. The second one, which you asked me about, you know, are there any other issues? There's a second issue, and that is almost all the trade that goes on from all African nations, from Angola, South Africa, Mozambique, you just name a country, is with outside countries. They don't trade with each other. That's kind of shocking, isn't it?
It's very shocking, and it leads me to another question about this. Does the political differences in various countries in Africa and the fact that some of them are overtly corrupt, does that not limit commerce and limit progress in the overall continent?
It absolutely does. There is corruption everywhere, and it's impossible to avoid that. I believe there was a watch group that just came out in the last 4 days that said that Nigeria was the sixth or seventh most corrupt country in the world. which had my minister of Nigeria shown up, we were going to talk about that. You know, is that really true or is that just an impression? You know, this program is all about getting to the bottom of the truth. So I don't like to read articles or read studies without asking the people to comment on it. And that was an opportunity here. But yeah, there's corruption through and through. And that's a culture that has to change. But when you think about it, when you're asking outsiders to bring in capital for very, very large projects and complex projects and long-term projects, it's already a risky proposition. Then when you layer on top of that political unrest, well, no wonder capital isn't coming into your country. Right.
Well, not only that, you investment, you know, everybody's going to shy away from an investment if they think the money's going to get siphoned off.
Right. And what you have is changes in regime. And when those regime changes happen, maybe there was a project like a hydroelectric plant and the next regime says, no, we're not going to do that anymore. And then how does everybody get paid?
Very slowly.
Right. Right. So one of the interesting things is that a lot of the banks that are within the countries inside of Africa, they're acting as brokers. What they do is they work with the government. They know the local culture. They know the officials. They know the processes. And then what they do is they go out and find international investors and then basically put together limited partnerships and they broker the deal. So what you have is the local banks working as an intermediary in many, many cases. And I think that's a good thing. I think it's always good to have feet on the street in a localized area if you're coming in to do a particular business. But even those banks are wanting to fund old infrastructure, which are asphalt roads and building more schools and more hospitals, as opposed to going to more efficient electronic solutions. So, you know, I even had conversations with them. And I talked to a lot of developmental agencies who have billions and billions of dollars available, but they're waiting for proposals. They're waiting for I don't know what they're waiting for, really. You know, I was on the verge of a little bit scolding because I said, look, there are no business plans that are perfect. I worked in Silicon Valley for 30 years, never seen one. So what are you waiting for? If you see the potential there, I think what you're doing is you're being too cautious and you're using the fact that the business plan doesn't have enough literal math in it that you don't want to fund it. What you really need to do is realize that you're not in the banking business, you're in the venture capital business. And so that brings me to my third issue that I addressed while I've been here at the G20, and that is the way in which capital is being invested in Africa is very backward. If you could think of it as a tube versus a funnel. In a tube, you're trying to get down to a decision to fund maybe one, two, or three large energy projects or large transportation projects. And what you're trying to do is look for money to be able to start the project and take it all the way to completion. So if you took that tube and you drew lines throughout the tube from one end to the other, you would have these projects that start at the top of the tube and end at the bottom of the tube, which is completion. But that forces you early on, before you can do any actual development, it forces you to choose. You have to pick which projects are a priority and which are most likely to deliver the highest return, the highest benefit to the society. And I would argue that these projects are so complex, why choose? Because the venture capital model doesn't force you to choose. And this is something that I offered a workshop in, and it was standing room only. I said, for the ministers, I would ask them to use a different economic model. I would ask them to do first round funding themselves without the private sector involved, just the governments to fund first round funding for infrastructure that looks like it would push the nation ahead. And then, just like a venture capitalist, at the end of that first round funding, there's an awful lot of those projects you're going to kill because they don't get that, they'll just die of starvation. You're not going to give them second round funding. But at the point at which you're looking for second or third round funding, bring the private sector in at that point. And there's a lot lot of reasons to do it that way. One, you don't have to decide up front. You have more empirical data. You can see what proves out to work and what doesn't. Number two, you've made a financial investment and a commitment. So therefore, when a private sector investor comes in, they can see that you've got project managers on the, you know, on the project, that you have a history of success, that your capital is at risk, your people's jobs are at risk. And so, you know, you've got some skin in the game in advance of trying to ask outside capital to come in. And the third benefit is that you've shortened the timetable. Remember, outside investors don't like to have big chunks of money tied up for such a long period of time. So if you've funded the first round, you've gone through the riskiest period, you've proven that the solution works. And so therefore, I think attracting outside capital would be enormously more easier to do. So I really tried to change the paradigm. Instead of picking massively expensive projects and just launching one, two, or three, and bringing private capital, which is resistant to putting their money at stake in an unstable political climate, instead of doing it that way, the government itself that has money now, because remember, they've given up oil licenses, they've got mineral licenses, so some money is coming into all of these African nations. They don't have to depend on private investment to get through that first round of funding.
And how was it now, received?
It was received tremendously because, as one minister said to me, he said, if we do it that way, we don't have to give so much away at the negotiating table because we've reduced the risk. And so Africa is in control of her infrastructure, not the private sector. Because you don't want to sell your infrastructure like hospitals, schools, utilities, roads, the generation of, you know, of hydroelectric, you know, power. You don't want to sell those things and then be beholden to other nations. And so it puts them in the driver's seat to get the best deal possible on behalf of Africa. Well, we've got to go to another commercial break. This hour is flying by, folks, and I'm having a great time talking to you. You hear from London at the G20 summit. We're going to take a short break and we'll be right back. You're listening to the Costa Report.
What does your website do for you? Does it simplify doing business and automate routine tasks? Does it connect with your target audience and bring new business? If you can't answer yes, then you need to contact Sunstar Media. Located on the Monterey Peninsula for over 17 years, Sunstar Media has developed websites for startups, brick-and-mortar stores, to corporations on the stock market. What makes Sunstar different is the customization that goes into every site, tailored to each client's unique needs and vision. Sunstar's experienced pros keep you ahead of the game with their custom-fit development process for website applications that cater to your company's specific needs. Learn more at sunstarmedia.com. Mention you heard this ad on the Rebecca Costa Show and get a free web analysis report on your current site or a free web consultation for your next project. Let's discuss how Sunstar can help you. Reach out to us at sunstarmedia.com.
Coast Paper and Supply has been family-owned and operated since 1948. They have a wide array of products available, including brand-name and eco-friendly cleaning supplies, paper goods, and compostable plates, cups, and cutlery. Whether your needs are for business or home, Coast Paper and Supply's friendly and reliable staff have what you're looking for. They even accommodate special orders. You can find them at 151 Josephine on River Street in Santa Cruz, Monday through Friday from 8 a.m. to 4:30, or call at 831-423-3350. Coast Paper and Supply is a proud member of Think Local First.
This Sunday on Eat, Drink, Explore Radio, details on why mosquitoes may like your skin more than others. Plus, saving money with shared hotel rooms and a clean water pledge by local craft brewers. Get the latest food, beverage, and travel news Sunday mornings 8 to 10 live right here on KSCO AM 1080. Eat, Drink, Explore Radio, your lifestyle information source.
From San Jose to Salinas, Red Hot News Talk, AM 1080, KSCO Santa Cruz.
This hour of the Costa Report is brought to you by Dole Food Company, the world's leading producer and distributor of fresh fruits and vegetables.
Welcome to the Costa Report. I'm Rebecca Costa, and thank you for joining me for the second hour of the Costa Report. This week, I'm speaking to you from the G20 summit in London, courtesy of the BBC. The theme of this summit has been investment in African infrastructure, and I had the honor of welcoming ministers and delegates and speaking about the important role collaboration has played over the long haul of human history, dating back to prehistoric times. I have to say that the optimism about Africa's future is very high at the conference, as we see a continued emphasis on public and private partnerships. But there's no question these partnerships continue to focus on oil and mineral interests. In just a few moments, senior analyst for the Center for Global Energy Studies, Mr. Manucher, I'm going to get that wrong, Manucher Takin will be joining me to take a look at whether oil exploration and development in Africa is likely to impact the price we pay at the pumps, or whether the rise in fuel prices has to do with something we don't hear in the mainstream media much about, something called upstream costs. But first, let me get started by telling you a little bit about our guest this hour, who you may have heard on CNN, Bloomberg, NPR, CNBC, or Al Jazeera. You might also know him from his insightful articles on oil and gas in the Wall Street Journal, Business Week, Time Magazine, and the Financial Times. Mr. Manucher Takin, boy, I'm just going to trip all over this, is not only a renowned geophysicist, but an expert on the global cost of oil production and worldwide supplies, as well as energy security, OPEC policy, and investments. Takin obtained his BSc in geology from Manchester University, his PhD in geophysics from Cambridge, and his MBA from the Industrial Management Institute in Tehran. As I mentioned earlier, he presently works for the Center for Global Energy Studies, but previously he served as secretariat to OPEC in Vienna and the National Iranian Oil Company and Amoco International. He's also a member of the Society of Petroleum Engineers and Exploration Society of Great Britain. It's my pleasure to welcome to the program today one of the world's most foremost authorities on just how much oil we have and how much we will pay for that oil. Mr. Takin, thank you for joining us today.
Well, thank you for the compliments and introduction. I think you're exaggerating. But anyway, I'm at the
That's impossible. You've been in this business a long time.
You know, it's a pleasure to be here anyway. Go ahead, please.
At the G20 conference this week, there's been a lot of discussion about the explosive transformation Africa's going through, primarily due to oil discoveries and mining. So perhaps we can kick the program off today by trying to understand what role Africa plays in these world oil markets today and how that's going to look down the road.
Well, it is a significant volume of production. We can go through the statistics if you like. It is not like the Middle East, but it is a significant volume. Mm-hmm. In total world oil supply, and it has been increasing in the last few years. West Africa, we knew of Nigeria going back decades ago, which was an area with oil, and Mobil's oil companies started there some years ago, or decades ago. But there have been revolutionary developments, finding oil in deep offshore Western Africa, and volumes have grown. So there are so many countries that 20 years ago we never thought of are now major producers. And East Africa, which exploration going back to 1960s and 70s did not result in anything, has resulted by small companies in very interesting oil and gas discoveries in places that the geologists were not thinking that much of being possible. previous, as I said, research hadn't found much. And these are revolutionizing because not only they are different from what people thought, but the volumes are really interesting.
So what percentage of the world oil market are they participating in now?
Well, I can't give you by hand. I can look at the numbers and tell you.
I know you're a numbers guy. Just an average.
Well, just,
is it 1% of the oil supply?
No, 5, 10%.
5 or 10% in that range.
Yes,
and has that just been recent?
Course,
has it gone 1 to 10% in the last decade?
I'm stretching myself just going by memory.
Mm-hmm.
It has increased, let's say, if it was 10%, it is now 15%. Or if it was 5%, it is now 10 to 15%. It has gone up that much, you see.
I see. So it's been exponentiating.
Yes. Yeah. And, of course, when we say Africa, it is a very general one. North Africa,
right.
Like Libya and Algeria, they have been producers for a very long time.
Mm-hmm.
And even West Africa, Nigeria has been a well-known oil province again for decades, you see. But there were these other countries, Angola and New Guinea and so many little ones. And East Africa that people never thought one can find oil, they have found oil in Rift Valley, in Eastern Africa, in so many countries, Uganda and so on. Mm-hmm. And they have found huge quantities of gas, especially offshore East Africa,
mm-hmm.
which are going to be producers because the volumes are so huge that there will be LNG projects. LNG is a liquefied natural gas when there is a lot of gas,
mm-hmm.
and the market is not nearby and you have to carry gas for thousands of kilometers to different markets.
Mm-hmm.
There you liquefy the gas,
mm-hmm.
under the very, very low temperatures, and which is called LNG, liquefied natural gas, and they transport it by tankers.
In that liquefied form.
That's right. Instead of just like oil tankers, these are LNG carriers, the specialized tankers, and they carry them around the world. And the major supplier, which is the biggest one, is Qatar in the Persian Gulf, which has a capacity of 77 million tons per year, whatever that might be. But that is supposed to be very big.
Mm-hmm.
Now, these gas discoveries offshore East Africa are going to be 80 or 90 when they actually come on the stream. But we are talking about several years yet, you see.
Mm-hmm.
But these are what I say paradigm shift, major revolutionary changes I mentioned have occurred. Africa, East,
so we'll be looking
east
at
and west.
Much more gas coming out of the
East
out of
Africa,
Africa,
natural gas. Definitely is there and is much more recent. The last few years, these huge ones. East African oil that people thought may not be being now discovered as well, both onshore and offshore, you see. So potential of Africa in supplying energy at these fossil fuels is much more than people thought, like analysts like myself, 10 years ago, you see.
Now, what do you say to folks who are afraid that we're going to run out of oil soon? I mean, I'm listening to you, and I've looked at some of the articles that you've written, and all of these recent discoveries, including the liquefying gas in quantities that we've never seen before. What do you say to people who are concerned we're going to run out any day now?
Mm-hmm.
And how do we quantify what's really available when we keep making these discoveries?
Well, this world running out of oil is a fact, and it will happen.
Mm-hmm.
So the people who talk about it, which we refer to, they call themselves peak oil theory supporters and believers in peak oil, is true. We have to respect them. Many of them, I knew them decades or many years ago as professional exploration people who had been working for major international companies 30 years, 40 years all over the world. And that is because the fossil fuels we are talking about, oil and gas, they are finite quantities.
Mm-hmm.
They are remnants from organic materials, living things, which over the few hundred million years of geological history of the Earth, mm-hmm. they accumulated in sediments. And over these years, gradually were buried under more sediments to great depths and were converted into hydrocarbons, oil, gas, and so on.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a finite quantity. It is not like wheat that we can grow every year, you see.
That's right.
So that is so.
But
what
should we be fearful we're
well,
on the
what
verge
I'm coming
of
to.
Running out?
That's what I'm coming to.
Yeah.
That at each time, let's say 50 years ago, or when in Pennsylvania in 18-something, 19th century oil, Colonel Drake found oil, after a few years, the wells stopped. And people thought that was the end of the oil, you see. And then there were other ones found, some more technology, new mm-hmm. innovations, Oklahoma. And then East Texas big, the so-called gusher was discovered.
Yes.
And made the prices become, you know, a few cents, and everyone became broke who had invested. So we have had these cycles that people think oil running out. As I told you, started from 19th century, just because that in the United States this is a well-known one.
That's right. But we have to, unfortunately, we have to take a short commercial break. But when we come back, we're going to find out how quickly we're going to run out. Because as I said, if they keep making new discoveries, that elongates the timetable. So I'm curious about whether we really are going to run out anytime soon. You're listening to the Costa Report.
This Legal Minute is brought to you by Nolan Hammerly Etienne and Haas, experienced attorneys providing professional legal services to the Central Coast for 85 years.
Hello, this is attorney Stephen Wagner with your Legal Minute. Have you ever said to yourself, there ought to be a law for that? Well, often there is. In today's segment, I will address the issue of distracted driving, and here's my opening salvo. Smartphones make dumb drivers. Of course, I'm talking about all those other drivers. The laws vary from state to state, but there is one common thread. These laws were legislatively put on the books because of the outcry of concern over drivers who are texting, talking, emailing, and tweeting. Distracted driving is nothing new. We used to look at the cows and pastures. Now we take photos with our smartphones. In California, there are over 20 million licensed drivers. 20 million! Here's a scary thought. Just think about how many of those 20 million own and use cell or smartphones. I can't possibly cover all the laws in all the states, but I can say that the trend is to prohibit or sharply curtail some uses of smartphones while driving. Whether this leads to a new species of liability remains to be seen, but one thing is clear. With each new feature and amazing breakthrough in technology comes a new and tempting distraction. As new laws go into effect, it will be interesting to see how this impacts the law of negligence. I predict that these new laws will expand the application of important negligence concepts such as duty, breach, and causation, thereby creating more liability theories. While we marvel at the great advances in technology and the cool things that our smartphones can do, they just keep on getting smarter. But do we? This is Stephen Wagner, and that's your Legal Minute.
Brought to you by Nolan Hammerly, Etienne & Haas. Selected in 2013 as one of the top law firms in the United States by Martindale Hubbell.
This alert just came in. This special announcement is for business owners and leaders of organizations who've been waiting for the right time to build. General Steel has made it impossible to wait any longer with rock-bottom prices that could save you thousands. That's right. General Steel, America's leader in pre-engineered structures, is offering buildings at prices you will never see again. Don't miss these specials. A 14 by 21 foot shop for under $6,000 or a 50 by 100 for under $30,000. You heard right. That's $5,000 square feet under $30,000. Manufacturers, if you need a larger building, try a 100 by 100 commercial building for $129,000. You can't afford to rent with these prices. Imagine a 70 by 100 foot church building for under $69,000. With the economy improving and interest rates still at historic lows, you can't afford to wait. So call 800-98-STEEL. You must act now. Call 800-98-STEEL. That's 800-987-8335.
All right, everybody, listen up. VitaminGoddess.com. That's right. VitaminGoddess.com or VitaminGod.com. What are you laughing at? What? You've heard me for years proclaim the advantages of getting all your essential supplements, vitamins, and minerals. But of course, where else? VitaminGoddess.com. You can remember that. VitaminGoddess.com. VitaminGoddess.com. Come on. Or VitaminGod.com. Why? Because it seems like everybody and their monkey's uncle is on the internet. So why not you? And if you are, check it out. Go see a beautiful website and a beautiful way to get all your supplements. VitaminGoddess.com or VitaminGod.com. And remember, may you live long and prosper.
Costa Report. I'm Rebecca Costa, and my guest is internationally respected oil and gas expert, Mr. Takin. And we've been discussing world oil reserves and the fact that they're making more and more oil discoveries, particularly in Africa, and how this will affect global markets. So we went to commercial break on a bit of a cliffhanger. You said that it's a fact that we are going to run out of oil in spite of all of these new discoveries. So do we have any idea when we would run out?
Well, as I was saying, there are periods that at based on the knowledge that we have, I'm talking about scientists, engineers, geologists, they think, well, from this information that we have, it will be another 10, 15 years, 20 years maximum that the world will run out of
Right,
oil.
We keep making predictions.
But 10 years later, the set of knowledge has changed. So again, they said 10 years, 20 years. So the data on the United States, which is your listeners are more familiar, is they always say in 10, 15 years' time, the so-called proved reserves of the United States, oil reserves, based on the amount of consumption today, they will last 10, 15 years, 20 mm-hmm. years maximum. But they have been on this 20-year maximum for the last century.
So the last century, we kept saying, in 20 years, we're running out, in 20 years, we're running out.
And the same thing for the world as such mm-hmm. has always been like this, the data. And I gave you the example of Colonel Drake in Pennsylvania, the late 19th century, running out and finding his Texas Gusher.
Right, they thought that was all the oil there was.
That's right. And then there was another one discovered, and then coming outside the United States. You have forgotten that. This was then at Azerbaijan in those days. You see, they found oil in the late 19th century, early 20th century, and people became billionaires, the noble family and so on. They were there. Anyway, and then Indonesia oil was found. So, you know, the rest of the world found so much oil afterwards, and this has continued. And then early 1908 was the first oil discovery in Iran.
So the safe answer here,
and then more oil in the Middle East.
I'm learning from you as a journalist. So the safe answer is to always say 15, 20 years, even 20 years from now, say 15, 20 years.
A good example is the United States itself. You see, since, as I said, late 19th century, it is a free market. It is open. The landowner has the right. You don't have to only... In the United Kingdom, the resources below belong to the crown. Mm-hmm. So the farmers are not keen for people come and dig because they don't get any revenue from the oil in their land. Whereas in the United States, they do have royalty rights.
What's below the surface of the land belongs to you.
So in that environment, which encourages landowners to give it to oil companies to come and dig holes and so on. And it is open market. It has been free marketplace in the world, right? So this is claimed to be the cradle of free market, free enterprise, entrepreneurship.
Well, I'm glad you bring this
after,
up.
After more than a century, we are now finding oil in Texas, Oklahoma, North Dakota, which people thought that's it, you see.
Right.
Not only 10,000.
We thought we'd found it all.
A few hundred thousand barrels per day. North Dakota was about 50,000 or 5,000. I can't remember now, a few years ago. It's now approaching 600,000-700,000 barrels per day, where people thought nothing. So that is it. New technology, new ideas always bring a new realm of resources which are there. But those resources are, again, are finite quantity. They are not being generated continuously. So that will run out. So at present, we could say, okay, when this phase is out, that will be the end. So that is, I think, a continuum of more technology, more ideas, and more importantly, it is investors who are prepared to put money and take risk, which have led to this. It has to be, you know, not venture capitalism, but venture capital is available in the environment of the United States. Mm-hmm. And that has encouraged this. In other parts of the world, then there are other, they follow up. The big major companies go, and the governments need to have companies invest and generate revenue. So there is that incentive for them to do. And so in the same way that we have had shale gas and shale oil, Texas, which has been the scraped through completely, Exxon and big companies have done the best they could. Then we had, was it TX, an entrepreneur company finding shale gas and shale oil. All and right. It was 3 years ago, Texas, Exxon, paid $41 billion to buy this company for more gas and shale in Texas, you see. Right. So these are examples. Why? Because this small company was the one was prepared to take risk and be aggressive and go for technologies that the majors are being conservative. They thought may not worth it. It may damage production record of the manager who is in charge of this particular area. You know, why do you go through this strange new technology? I use the technology which is already established. Whereas the new company is prepared to do it. And they did it and they found...
Right, all startups and then take Exxon additional risk.
Exactly. Yeah. And Exxon. So it is really by this. I really don't have an answer for you. But again, as wasn't the case for the world total, I think about 20, 30 years' time is probably the knowledge is that we will reach, not the world will run out suddenly, we will reach a peak, let's say in 20 years' time, mm-hmm. and then gradually production will decline and decline and decline. It's not that we go to the cliff and then that's it, we fall off.
So, no, this isn't you're going to wake up one morning, turn the spigot, and no water's coming out. I think that no one has any fear of that, but I think what will happen as we get closer to that cliff, and it's a gradual process, the pricing will go up so high.
Signs would show it.
That it'll be prohibitive to anybody.
Right?
You'll have to mortgage your house to get a gallon of gas. At that point, gas is over.
Yes.
It won't be gone. It's just not affordable.
By which time, something new has come. Which will make the rest of that oil redundant.
Well,
you should not forget, but coal
maybe.
Was the end.
We are such oil junkies.
Coal was, we believe so, but we think so. But when new technology, new things come, we will be the whole world. Consumers will be consumer of other things, as coal was the engine of industrial revolution for two centuries.
Okay, so I want to switch subjects for a minute. I want to talk to you about pricing because
it's the
pump price that we all get concerned about, and these prices have been largely set by consortiums like OPEC. And in that sense, do we really have a free market at all? Because I don't understand how we have a free market if the price is being set and all countries are abiding by that same price. I mean, you don't have any country making a move and saying, all right, we're not going to agree to that price and we're going to go just like the Japanese flooded the U.S. market with memory chips. At some point, they said, we don't care what the U.S. is charging memory chips. We're going to, and so I remember going into an electronics store and they had a chalkboard and every minute they were erasing it and the price was going down. It was falling. It was really falling off a cliff and almost put Intel out of business at that time. You don't see anybody making a move. You don't see an African country saying, we're going to make a move and we're going to go in at half the price that OPEC has set. So that sounds like a rigged deal. Am I wrong about that?
Well, I'm afraid you're not exactly correct. Be more polite.
Well, that would not be the first time, by the way.
You see, one cannot beat the markets. So supply-demand is a golden rule which will apply whatever you do. And no matter governments, major companies, big companies try to corner and organize and monopolies, oligopolies and so on, it is up to a certain extent. Because then new producers will come in and try to beat.
That's right.
Just like the Japanese came in, etc. You were talking about the chips. So oil is this. You should not overrule that. Should not forget about it, that it is supply and demand. But in the case of oil, it is not a quantity, it is a solid thing. It is the flow. It is the flow of oil and the flow of rate of as comes in and the demand. It is the balance of the flows and not an absolute quantity.
I see. We have to take a short commercial break. And when we come back, we're going to talk more about the pricing of oil as well as the dangerous relationship between security and oil. You're listening to the Costa Report.
As many of us age, we are now facing the prospect of making sure our final wishes are carried out if we become seriously ill. We worry that even if we've selected healthcare agents, our healthcare documents may not be available when they're needed most. Hello, my name is John Lawton. I'm an elder law attorney and have been helping families in our community make sure that their final wishes are carried out. There are simple ways to do this, but unfortunately, they aren't widely followed. I see cases every day where families could have protected themselves and didn't. Call me at 831-649-1122 or visit my website at estateplan-lawyers.com. That number again is 831-649-1122. There's no need to put your peace of mind at risk. Make that call today.
Is your computer running real slow like this? Or are you getting the blue screen of death? Do you have to do a restart several times a session? Tired of viruses, spyware, malware, and slow, worthless tech support? Face it, it's too late to download another free PC fix-it program, thinking it'll be restored to out-of-box purity. Oh, no, 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 no. You need the fast, friendly computer pros at User-Friendly Computing. Just drop it off at their office at 505 River Street across from the Gateway Plaza, or give them a call at 831-423-9653, and they'll come to you. Mention KSCO and get a free $50 diagnostic. PC or Mac, desktop or laptop, they can do it all at User-Friendly Computing. Call 831-423-9653.
My name is Mickey Phelps here from Crown Cafe and Scotts Valley Market. I just wanted to let you know that Scotts Valley Market has some amazing prices on meat and produce and, of course, throughout the store. Jared and his crew from the meat department will be more than happy to cut a nice filet mignon to your liking. Also, Scotts Valley Market has an amazing hot food bar, and also we make some of the best sandwiches in town, like the Irish. So, folks, come on in and you'll find out that Scotts Valley Market has some amazing everyday deals. Also, at Scotts Valley Market, be sure to look for those yellow tags. That's where you're going to save a lot of money. And we'll be sure that we are very competitive with other grocery stores out there. What makes us different is that we are local and family-owned. So come on in. And while you're there, be sure to ask for Mickey. And don't forget that if you need any catering, give Crown Cafe a call at 831-566-1425. 831-566-1425.
Why does the United States spend the largest percentage of GDP in the world on health care? Why do we have the highest cancer rates on the planet, the highest rates of diabetes, autism, and every other major disease? It all comes down to one thing. We are what we eat. Our food is devoid of nutrition and processed with poisons and additives. Our water is filled with toxic poisons and big pharma runoff. We can turn the tide against those who seek to profit by making and keeping us unhealthy by giving ourselves the nutrients our bodies desperately need. To learn more, go to KSCOhealth.com. The site is literally packed with audio and video featuring top health professionals who don't bow down to Big Pharma. The fight against servitude starts with you, and you can't stand against the machine if you are sick, tired, and obese. When you visit KSCOhealth.com, be sure to check out the catalog with nearly 400 life-changing products and get free shipping when you sign up for auto ship.
Welcome back to the Costa Report. I'm Rebecca Costa, and I'm reporting live from the G20 summit today. And I am with oil and gas expert Mr. Tuckeen, who was talking a little bit to us about how oil gets priced around the world. I was curious that as demand goes down, let's say everybody starts driving a Prius, everybody goes to solar energy. As demand goes down, should prices go down, or will they go up?
Well, they would go down. You see, price is a subject of supply and demand. You can't beat that.
But you would think so.
Yes, that is a golden rule, as I was saying just before our break. And so if demand is going down, there should be downward pressure on the price. Mm-hmm. But it is not only the buying and selling physically of oil now. Because of the huge quantity of money involved, financial players come in, invest it, and you can buy futures. You can buy ahead.
Right, and so they're buying oil that hasn't materialized yet, right. So at a much higher price.
Well, that could be higher or lower.
Is it a higher or lower price?
It could be higher or lower based on the perception of the man or the person,
so
the lady who's putting the money.
So are we in a situation here with futures where we're determining the future?
Yeah, this is a big debate.
I know this is a big debate. If you're buying futures and you need those futures to pay off, does that in some way influence the price that gas will have in the future?
Which is physically now, yes.
Yeah.
No, in the future. You see, we have physical buying and trading, which as an oil company sells to a refining company. Okay, it doesn't have to be any futures screen. But it is not as simple. That has been going on, physical trading all the time. But alongside, together with this, now for the next month, for the next 3 years, and so on. This futures trading has been going on, which is the volume of trades about 10 times, 20 times the actual volume of oil being bought and sold.
That's right.
It is this interaction.
They're speculating.
That's right.
They're basically speculating on where oil
is
going to go.
That is what I said, perception.
So does it become a self-fulfilling prophecy is my question.
It could be.
Well, because it certainly seems like it's headed in that direction.
But there could also be manipulation. And that is, U.S. Congress 2-3 years ago, they had a big debate and people presentation, evidences given and so on. It wasn't still clear cut. Enron, you know, with the electricity in California, they were actually manipulating the market.
Oh, now we have this case in England now of manipulation of energy markets.
So, again, it is the perception and to put money, how much you put in, either deliberately or honestly, people are carried away by rumors and so on. So the supply demand, expectations, rumors, huge financial players, those who actually play casino and speculation play games. Not people buy and sell who don't know what oil is.
Well, I have often said this. There are no facts about the future. That's why we call it the future.
Yes.
Right? There are only facts about the past, not the future. Mm-hmm. So to a certain extent, these decisions are very emotional. And so media speculation, media stories, anything can really cause those future markets to go upward or downward
based on
panic.
Yes. Like some years ago, I was on a program like this, and some in the petrochemical plant, there had been an accident in western Saudi Arabia by the Red Sea, in the petrochemical plant, which has nothing to do with the oil supply. And oil price went $2, $3 up. So a few years ago.
Even though it had nothing to do,
and
factually.
I explained that the actual oil is on the East Coast, Ras Tanura, and that is crude oil export, and this is not even refining, it's petrochemicals, etc. So there you are, it is there. But you can't have a perception and a speculation overriding the market fundamentals. It is really a mixture of both two, and the main question was politics. That, God forbid, wars, which cause tragedy and a loss of life, they also cause disruption of oil. So the fear of that and politicians employing, using oil, saying this and that. Oil countries that have oil, produce oil, nationalizing their oil industry that we have in the last 30, 40 years or 1930s.
Yeah,
we had Mexico nationalizing.
Wars require a lot of oil,
so
too, so you increase demand at the same time.
Fear of nationalization, fear of disruption because of war, economy booming. In the next year or two, are you pretty optimistic that we are coming out of recession, the U.S. everywhere booming in the 2 years' time, and too much oil? Or is it going to be a recession and depression in the next 3, 4, 5 years?
At the risk of having you leave the studio today, I just bought a Prius. That's how optimistic I am.
No, but if I'm buying and selling oil, I should have a concept of what global economy would be, and therefore what demand would be, and so on. But people really use their what they have in their mind quickly, and the transactions are done instantaneously. You know, it is, we can sit, do analysis, spend hours and hours. It doesn't go like that way. They have the analysis given to them, but no one reads them. It is the traders who are there all the time, and they get the news of politics. So political news, like what happened in Egypt, that they thought oil would stop. Whereas, in fact, then they thought, well, that was, you know, an hour later or say 1 day later, they realized. You know,
as a person who's been in this field for so long, are you ever amazed at how easily the public is fooled and how emotionally they react to the marketplace? Even though there's no factual basis, you must sit back and say, there is no reason for the price to go up $2 and $3. That accident, that shipping accident has nothing to do whatsoever with oil supplies.
Mm-hmm. Well, I have wondered myself, but this, I'm only looking at the oil, which I think I know something about it. But there are so many things in this world which affect our global economy that I'm not aware. And my reaction would be based on the news and my not detailed technical analysis and response.
Right.
If I were in a decision-making position, I would not be an expert on every aspect of the economic, of the global economy or the region that I'm in charge. So I make my decisions based on my advisors, my boss. I have trading. I have to have a deadline to meet and so on. Unfortunately, this is the way the whole world runs like this. And the skeptics talk about politicians going into war and causing tragedies, not that they sat analysis think tanks saying that the war is good or bad. Things happen, you see, and that is the worry that we all have. But that is beyond oil. That's right.
So let's move on to the topic of security, because it's difficult to talk about oil and gas without talking about national security. We know the great deal of funding for terrorist organizations originated in Saudi Arabia, a critical oil partner for the United States, and yet we continue to trade with the Saudis in spite of that evidence. So we have a situation on the one hand with the Saudis, and then we turn around and put sanctions on Iran as an example. So to me, if you can trace terrorism into Saudi Arabia and you keep trading in terms of oil with Saudi Arabia, but you want to turn around and you want to punish Iran. Now, I know you've spoken about this double standard when it comes to painting Iran as a, you quote, say, boogeyman. So maybe you could speak to the security issues we face in the Middle East and whether they're, these sanctions really are effective in any way, and whether we should lift those sanctions, whether having sanctions on trading really doesn't work.
Well, in general, the U.S. listeners would know that the philosophy is to let the world, first of all, within a country, within this town, next town, people should be freely trading with each other. And when you try to control trade, always you are distorting the market. And at the end, we will all lose. That is what we are taught at economics at school, at universities, and so on. Right. So in general, in principle, imposing sanctions and controlling supply and so on by force beyond the market forces, beyond what natural consumers would like and so on, distorts things. And you might manage it politically 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, but at the end, the whole thing would distort and we will all lose. And putting sanctions is really like that. I think sanctions are a public policy tool, but they are a very ineffective one. They are a very blunt tool, so to speak, as used by politicians around the world.
But we always hear that they're employing economic sanctions because the alternative, which is military action or something even more severe, is an even blunter instrument.
Well, that would be a tragedy when we talk about wars. And military action.
But isn't it true that economic sanctions always are a prelude to war?
Well, I hope not. God forbid. I hope it wouldn't. But we are not talking. I don't want to get into politics because I don't consider myself a political scientist and an expert on politics. And being an Iranian, which I'm proud to be so, by Persian heritage, then I may be sort of carried away to say so much. But I think trying to myself to keep myself cool and looking from the side, I think putting sanctions on Libya, on Iraq, in the past, and now on Iran, is really
not in the interest of the United States,
and nobody else really. Because if you are trying to change a regime of a country, sanctions would not be effective.
That's not the way.
In case of South Africa, again, they were not effective. That is a good example.
That's a very good example. Now we have to take our last break, and we'll be back right after this brief message from our sponsors. You're listening to the Costa Report. Now here's something to think about. If we're having the same problems in the United States that every other country is struggling with, then are these problems really domestic issues? At what point do we wake up and say, hey, if it's happening to everyone, it means it's happening to our species? That's why I'm asking you to read The Watchman's Rattle, because when you do, you'll see that the very idea that there are domestic and international threats is a myth. All of the problems we face today, problems like unemployment, debt, climate change, terrorism, nuclear proliferation, even the spread of pandemic viruses involve other nations. So please take a moment to pick up The Watchman's Rattle. It's a perspective you'll not find anywhere else, and it offers us solutions you won't find anywhere else. Get The Watchman's Rattle. Do it now. You'll be glad you did.
Hi, I'm Amy Tobin, cookbook author and culinary expert. Are you looking for ideas to create a more balanced meal plan? As one of the world's largest providers of fresh fruits and vegetables, Dole makes it easy to eat the right foods. From a wide variety of salad blends and all-natural salad kits to fresh-cut vegetables and a rainbow of your favorite fresh fruit, Dole delivers good nutrition naturally. But Dole goes beyond just offering healthy fruits and vegetables. Dole has their own nutrition institute that gives you the knowledge and tools you need to make smart choices about your nutrition and health. Visit www.dole.com for more information about the Dole Nutrition Institute. Be sure to sign up for their e-newsletter to receive delicious recipes, tips, and articles to help you make your meals the best they can be. Visit www.dole.com for more.
Hey, buddy, it's me, your laptop. That's right, your little modern marvel of technology you've been abusing for months. Dude, we need to talk. Do you really think that those free PC Fix-It programs are any match for today's spyware and malware? Not to mention the NSA and some of those websites you've been visiting. Now, I'm not here to judge, I'm just saying. You need to take me to Peter and the friendly staff at User Friendly Computing to get me back into tip-top shape.
Tired of unfriendly computer support, slow computer, viruses, spyware? No problem. Call the friendly computer experts at User Friendly Computing. We take care of all your PC, Macintosh, and laptop needs. Mention KSCO and get a free $50 diagnostic. Visit us today at 505 River Street on the way to downtown Santa Cruz, across from Gateway Plaza. We give you a choice. Drop your computer by the shop, or we'll come to you. Call us today at 423-9653. User Friendly Computing.
This alert just came in. This special announcement is for business owners and leaders of organizations who've been waiting for the right time to build. General Steel has made it impossible to wait any longer with rock-bottom prices that could save you thousands. That's right. General Steel, America's leader in pre-engineered structures, is offering buildings at prices you will never see again. Don't miss these specials. A 14 by 21 foot shop for under $6,000 or a 50 by 100 for under $30,000. You heard right. That's $5,000 square feet under $30,000. Manufacturers, if you need a larger building, try a 100 by 100 commercial building for $129,000. You can't afford to rent with these prices. Imagine a 70 by 100 foot church building for under $69,000. With the economy improving and interest rates still at historic lows, you can't afford to wait. So call 800-98-STEEL. You must act now. Call 800-98-STEEL. That's 800-987-8335.
Welcome back to the Costa Report. I'm Rebecca Costa, and my guest today is oil and gas analyst from the Center for Global Energy Solutions, Mr. Takim. And, you know, we were talking about the fact that sanctions are not necessarily effective. We like to think they are, and they seem to be a political tool that's just more noise than anything else. Is there any historical precedence for continuing to trade with a nation like Iran who may be hostile toward the United States, may have some hostile policies?
Well, I think part of what, as we were discussing, it is the, you were discussing Saudi Arabia and the way the United States is relying, has been relying on it. This goes back, relying on the oil from Saudi Arabia. This goes back to the early 19th century when the U.S. president and the old king Abdulaziz of Saudi Arabia met on a warship in the Red Sea, and they had to put a tent on the deck for him because that is the way he was. This is the old Abdulaziz.
Yes.
And alliance was made at that time that Saudi Arabia would provide oil and supply oil and stabilize a stable supply of oil to the United States. And the U.S. then would support the regime. And this has been going on now, you know, for several decades, you see. So that has been, I think the way you started this question in the previous bit was on this relationship. This has been going on for many decades. This is because, of course, Saudi Arabia had a huge reserve. This is after the huge discoveries.
So is that how the game is played? You literally go in, you cut a deal, you say you'll give us a consistent supply of oil, the oil that we need to protect ourselves, to run our economy, and we support your regime.
That's right. This has been.
That's kind of how it's.
This is nothing new. This has been in all the books have been published, and all this is. So-called unclassified records.
So what do you say to people?
Many university professors have written on it. It's nothing that I'm just, you know,
sure.
That is the reality.
Okay, that doesn't sound revolutionary, but on the other hand, things are changing because there's other places you can shop for oil, right? You don't have to trade with people who you don't really support, their morality, their ethics,
treatment of women. No, I don't
think
you can. The world cannot do without Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia's oil production is at present about 9 to between 9 and 10 million barrels per day. And total world oil supply is about 90 or 85 or so million barrels per day.
Okay,
so
you know what I'm going to ask you? When will they run out?
So they
because that's a finite product, right?
That we agree
that's finite.
That would be 80 years, 70 years. No,
it's
they have
too long.
So that is the whole point. That is the importance of Saudi Arabia. It is the holder of the largest reserve, proved reserves, which are not just stories. They're actual reserves which have been tested. They are there. Oil is there. Some people have been saying that, no, this is exaggeration. Books have been written and so on. I've been in debates with the...
what's your opinion? Is it the largest reserve we know?
Yes, it has, definitely. Mm-hmm. And more important is the largest production capacity. Saudi Arabia has all the facilities, installations to produce 12 million barrels per day oil. Mm-hmm. And this is true. It's not just stories and exaggeration. And so it is this which is a major kingpin both for the supply of oil and within OPEC, which are oil producers sitting together and discussing, is always what the Saudi policy is, which is an important one within OPEC as an organization. So I think that is really the dilemma if I were, as a politician, to follow my moral and humanitarian and idealistic decisions or factors, or on the realities of real politics, so to speak, and the need of economics, revenue, trade, and so on, which has been there. I think if you talk to the kings and queens and presidents over the last 20, 30, and read their mind, they always know these, what you are telling, but they have to somehow manage. So in the case of Saudi Arabia, the government have been saying that we are committed to provide supply of oil. The minister has said they are committed to have 2 million barrels per day of oil production capacity minimum, always ready in case there is disruption in the world. Saudi Arabia has always this 2 million
barrels. They have the reserves
spare,
ready.
Not yeah. reserves.
Right.
Develop reserves, the spare production capacity, you see. Mm-hmm. So this is what Saudi Arabia has, and I think this is we have to appreciate that and accept it as a...
But what's to stop the United States from going in and subsidizing an African nation, for example, mm-hmm. one of these African nations that's shown up at the G20 summit, needs funding for infrastructure, and say, listen, we want you to develop... Right, and produce these barrels that you have on reserve
for us. But the reserves are not there. You see, that's the whole point.
Well, they're not there now, but we...
But maybe we could... from all these new technologies and so on. That is what I said. Things are changing and so on. But these new technologies and developments over the last 50 years have come. And on many occasions, if you look at the president's, U.S. president's State of Union addresses for the last 30, 40 years, I think... At least 80%, they refer that the U.S. wants to reduce its dependence of oil from the Middle East. Mm-hmm. But it has been the aim, but it hasn't happened because oil in other parts of the world are not that huge. For example, with West African finding so much oil in the last few years, many congressmen in the USA say, now we have alliances with West Africa, we don't need to rely on the Middle East, mm-hmm. and especially Saudi Arabia. But in practice, really, although they are good, those reserves are interesting. The production has gone up, but still
it takes time to build
the
infrastructure. The
reserve
the
reserve base is not as big, so even allowing time, they cannot produce to get to the production levels to be able to do without Saudi Arabia.
Right, but there are two levers on this machine. Really, there's reducing demand at the same time that you look elsewhere. Right, for inventory to be available, right, and to help create that inventory in friendlier nations, like some of the nations in Africa right now.
Well, reduction of demand has been a policy both in the industrialized countries and in the developing countries. If you look at the U.S. consumption per capita or per car, 20 years ago, 30 years ago, it is now much less. You were talking about your price as an example. Mm-hmm. But if you look at the United States now, compared with Europe, the average car consumption is still very high.
It's still very high.
Miles per gallon.
Like trucks.
But President Obama is now having, but also the regulation. President Obama, I think, is having the regulation of 30 miles per gallon being imposed. I've forgotten. There are these bills going on in the Congress. I have lost track of them. From about 20 miles per gallon to 30 to 40 miles per gallon. In Europe, it's about 30, 40 miles. And some cars are about 70 miles per gallon. So... looking at the United States with these regulations which are in the pipeline, I think there is a downward pressure, trend in oil consumption. Mm-hmm. So in the last few years, U.S. gasoline consumption has been going down. and the views on it will go down. If this 20 mile per gallon, let's say to 40 mile per gallon, is actually implemented, the fleet of cars gradually will go out, the new ones coming with this efficiency, by about 2030 or so, U.S. oil consumption would fall by about 2 million barrels per day, or would be 2 million barrels per day less than we try to extrapolate now, you see. So this is an example of what I just said. Efficiency, reducing demand, savings, conservation, these are all solutions, as well as substitution, to find something which will replace the oil, which I
but
said.
But on the other hand, as our demand goes down, China's demand skyrockets.
Yes, but Chinese...
So we're not going to really see
but
anything.
But Chinese are
right?
also going to be efficient. The U.S. steel production in China
over
is not
time.
Going to be like what it was 1950s right. of Soviet Union. They're also efficient in everything, in both transportation, industry, and so on.
Well, on that note, that is all the time that we have left. Before we let you go, I do want to thank you for joining me at the BBC studios today and for helping us to understand the global oil perspective. Thank you, Mr. Tuckeen. That's our program for this hour. But if you'd like to comment on today's show, you can email me at my website at RebeccaCosta.com. That's my name, RebeccaCosta.com. And you can also share your comments about today's show on our Twitter, Facebook, and LinkedIn pages. We're pretty much everywhere on the internet. And if you missed the full interview with Mr. Tuckeen or any of our other previous guests, you can download episodes from our website and our new YouTube channel. I hope you'll visit that. It's the folks that are in charge of our YouTube channel have just done a marvelous job, so I hope you'll stop in and take a look. And you can download previous episodes from our Apple iTunes site, and as well as Podbean. Next week, my guest is the former director of the National Security Agency and the Central Intelligence Agency, Mr. Michael Hayden. Hayden is going to weigh in on the fate of Edward Snowden. And boy, is that a tale. You just know that somebody in Hollywood's getting ready to make a great movie on that. And also the NSA telephone surveillance controversy. And he's going to help us understand just how delicate the balance is between assuring security and honoring our right to privacy. And that's a very delicate balance. It's a lot like our relationship with hostile countries and purchasing oil. I think these are all gray areas, and they deserve our attention. They deserve us to have open conversation and to be seeking facts over unsubstantiated beliefs. So don't miss Michael Hayden next week on the Costa Report, the one program you can count on week after week to put principles ahead of politics. Until then, I'm Rebecca Costa, and thank you for joining me for this edition of the Costa Report.
What does your website do for you? Does it simplify doing business and automate routine tasks? Does it connect with your target audience and bring new business? If you can't answer yes, then you need to contact Sunstar Media. Located on the Monterey Peninsula for over 17 years, Sunstar Media has developed websites for startups, brick-and-mortar stores, to corporations on the stock market. What makes Sunstar different is the customization that goes into every site, tailored to each client's unique needs and vision. Sunstar's experienced pros keep you ahead of the game with their custom fit development process for website applications that cater to your company's specific needs. Learn more at sunstarmedia.com. Mention you heard this ad on the Rebecca Costa Show and get a free web analysis report on your current site or a free web consultation for your next project. Let's discuss how Sunstar can help you. Reach out to us at sunstarmedia.com.
Why does the United States spend the largest percentage of GDP in the world on health care? Why do we have the highest cancer rates on the planet, the highest rates of diabetes, autism, and every other major disease? It all comes down to one thing. We are what we eat. Our food is devoid of nutrition and processed with poisons and additives. Our water is filled with toxic poisons and big pharma runoff. We can turn the tide against those who seek to profit by making and keeping us unhealthy by giving ourselves the nutrients our bodies desperately need. To learn more, go to kscohealth.com. The site is literally packed with audio and video featuring top health professionals who don't bow down to big pharma. The fight against servitude starts with you, and you can't stand against the machine if you are sick, tired, and obese. When you visit kscohealth.com, be sure to check out the catalog with nearly 400 life-changing products and get free shipping when you sign up for auto ship.
From San Jose to Salinas, Red Hot News Talk, AM 1080 KSCO Santa Cruz.